So anyway, let's talk about the human exploitation kill chain. So, oh, go back a slide. Ah, who cares? Anyway, so here's the thing. Well, let's see if I can go back. Yay, everything works. So anyway, what happens is, with the human exploitation kill chain, here's the problem. When people talk about awareness, every time a user does something stupid, they're like, awareness doesn't work. Stupid user and all that sort of stuff. You know, it's like whether he puts a USB drive in to take down a whole nuclear processing facility, they click on a phishing message, which pretty much locks up all the devices and all that stuff. Everybody says, stupid user. I'm like, if a user can click on a link or put a USB drive in and take down your whole network, your network sucks. So you got to start realizing that it's not the stupid user. I mean, well, there are some really stupid users, don't get me wrong. But at the same time, you got to start realizing it's not the user. The user can do some actions, but at the same time, you can't create an infrastructure that allows a user to do stupid things. Something that's not in these slides I should talk about anyway is there's a concept in safety. In safety, I did an awareness program for a customer, and I was talking to their safety people, and the guy told me that we basically went around and figured out what are the environmental concerns that create most of the safety problems, like where the accidents occurring. And they found out that 90% of all accidents happened because not, you know, the user, but because the environment created something where the user would make mistakes. So for example, they painted a yellow line around the workbenches and around the aisles so that people would know to stay within these aisles. And I'm like, that's simple? They're like, yeah, now people aren't walking into hot soldering irons or things sticking off the work tables. I'm like, wow. So they figured out that 90% was basically due to how the environment was set up, and 10% of accidents were due to either carelessness or poor training or, you know, just outright stupidity. So again, if you look at something like this, the goal is to take care of the 90% of the problems. Because again, if a user can take down your network sucks, so get that through your head. So let's talk about the problem, which I already started talking about. For the most part, God, I hate this thing. Anyway, so talking about the users, what happens is the humans always consider the weakest link. They say, let's blame the user if something happens. We put millions of dollars in or hundreds of millions, and then a user can come by and bypass anything. How many people have seen that Dave cartoon where you see like a guy in a boxing ring, and then it's like in this corner we have tens of thousands of dollars in security equipment. In this corner we have Dave, which looks like a big fat slob sitting there. And that's what most people think about security. But anyway, so you look at these things. So phishing, you know, you look at phishing, and yes, a user action somehow is required to like launch an attack. Yeah, that's a given. But if for phishing, USB drops, all these other attacks, social engineering, they've been devastating. And you can't just have those circumstances. So they question the value of awareness. And this is really frustrating for me because, yeah, I do awareness as a profession, but the reality is, it's like you can't call into question the whole awareness program because of a few user actions. I mean, frankly, has anybody ever seen encryption fail? Has anybody ever seen antivirus software fail? Has anybody ever seen like system security fail? Every other technology fails, but somehow awareness is the only one that is not forgiven as being an inevitable failure. It's all awareness is worthless. So we might as well just say, well, encryption's worthless, you know, USB drives are worthless, and so on. Now the reality, like I already mentioned, successful attacks result from a systematic failure. It results from a systematic failure in both encryption, or sorry, not just encryption, but technology, processes, human resources, and everything else. And it takes a failure of technology at multiple levels to allow a user action to totally screw things up. And you know, I'll give you like a Snowden case, because God, I hate that guy, and I'm trying not to curse as I say this. But you know, with Snowden, for example, there was like downloading of lots and lots of data. Yeah, he had administrator privileges on some, he stole other people's accounts on others, but why did the network not detect gigabytes of downloads and everything like that? Why did it allow a USB drive to be plugged into a system and be taken in and out of a facility that's highly classified? Now, taking that to a different way with phishing, there's basically, you know, I'll define this a little bit later because phishing is the most obvious example for a lot of this. But with phishing, there's 10 layers of potential failure. Only two of those layers actually involve a person doing something wrong. The other 8 layers involve technology failures or systematic failures. So you got to start looking at this, and that'll be broken down later. Like I mentioned before, though, awareness isn't perfect. Frankly, most awareness programs outright suck. And I'll talk about why they suck a little bit later. But you gotta go ahead and acknowledge, yes, awareness is like any other security tool, any other countermeasure, and it's gonna fail no matter what you do. Because frankly, just like a network can take many forms, people take many forms, and nothing's gonna be perfect. And there's a study that somebody found, I found it, I can't remember where it is, so somebody find it again, please. But there was a study that said 90% of all user-based damages are the result of 5% of the people. Basically, 95% of the problems is the result of 5% of the people. So basically, 5% of the people cause 95% of the damage. The other 5% create, again, and the other 5% of damage, and so on. Hopefully that made sense, and I kept the numbers straight. So now, like I mentioned before, most awareness programs are not awareness programs. For lack of a better term, most awareness programs are phishing simulations. How many people run phishing simulations or whatever? Okay, so now, all of you can attest, when you run a phishing simulation, what's the first thing you do? You whitelist the phishing messages, right? So what happens when you whitelist phishing messages? You're basically sending messages to users that would never reach the users anyway. Think about that by definition. So phishing messages are based on messages that would never, or phishing simulations were based on messages that would never get to the users. So think that's your primary phishing prevention. But even if that's your only thing, that, you know, phishing is one small sliver of what awareness is. What about password security, physical security, you know, USB drives, mobile devices, and so on. Those concerns have to be met. And how do most people meet it? They basically meet it by mandatory CBTs, computer-based training. So yeah, how many people ever got anything out of a CBT that you remembered? Anybody? Well, two people, three. Actually, congratulations. You are the weird ones, no offense. But so anyway, those people get it. But most of the awareness is focused on specific situations. Most people say, somebody will call you up. Do not give them your password. Well, what if they call you up and ask you to modify the registry file? Well, nobody ever told me not to do that. You know, so you got to go ahead and think about awareness training can't be about not what you should do. But I'll cover this later. It should be about what a user should be doing, not what a user should not be doing, because really what awareness should be about is good. What are the policies, procedures, and guidelines within the organization, and encouraging people to pretty much implement policies, procedures, and guidelines, which if they followed, they would not fall for the attacks, because they would say, I'm sorry, I'm not supposed to do this. If you want me to send money, I need you to get the proper authorization. You know, the CEO never called me up before, so I'm pretty sure the CEO doesn't want me to just send out $50 million randomly to a law firm that nobody ever heard of in Cyprus, for example, which happens. So anyway, and then here's the other part. Even smart people make mistakes. How many of you in this room have ever clicked on a phishing message accidentally? How many of you have ever done something you would call stupid user-ish? And I am one of those people. I admit it. And sometimes it's not even my fault. Well, it's never my fault, obviously. But sometimes it's not my fault because, like, I'm trying to click on the wrong link and my cursor's over the wrong space. It goes to the wrong window. And it's like I accidentally open up the message instead of deleting it because their buttons are right next to each other. But that happens. And again, that's an environmental concern. But you have to account for accidents happening. Because here's another thing that people lose track of in the security profession. Everybody wants to learn how to stop the hackers. They want to learn how to stop the Russian spies and all these things. Those are malicious attacks. The reality is most of the damage people face are from malignant attacks. Malignant attacks are things that exist, and I shouldn't call them attacks, but malignant issues. So for example, during Homeland Security, and this is like after the 9/11 attacks, everybody said, well, you know those placards on the side of trucks and railroad cars? We need to take those placards off because a terrorist will see there's chlorine gas in a railroad car and they will attack that railroad car. And everybody's like, wow, that's a malicious attack we all need to worry about. But then the firefighters are coming, you can't take those off. There are train derailments every day, day after day. And if one of those cars is carrying chlorine gas, we need to know about it or else we can kill even more people by not knowing about it. So everybody's afraid of the hackers and everybody else. But the reality is that good, well-meaning users cause more problems than a malicious actor would ever consider how to do. I've deleted lots of files accidentally, deleted emails, had a search. Hopefully there were backups. But again, accidents happen and cause more damage than malicious people do on a regular basis. So keep that in mind. Now, there are technology failures, and again, I just have this because RSA said you need lots of pictures because they hired some consultant. I mean, the consultant ones, they would be happy if we took all the words off and just put a picture on every slide. How many people think that's stupid? I mean, I think it's stupid, and I'm not going to do it, but, you know, pictures allow me to make fun of people, too, so I like it. Anyway, so technology failures. When you look at a kill chain is basically a military concept that there are many phases of an attack. And so when you look at many phases of the attack, in any phase of the attack, that's essentially a point of vulnerability. It can also be a point of protection or a point of stopping the attack cold. So you have to try to look at the kill chain, understand it, and figure out where is the best place to mitigate a potential attack. So let's see. So everybody was like big on Russia. Russia, the military power. Sorry, I'm trying not to talk about Trump too much, but God, I don't like the guy. I'll admit it. So anyway, you know, you're talking about Russia sending their one working aircraft carrier around the northern sea down into the Mediterranean to support Syria. Now, I used to work at NSA, so let's say I know a little bit about this stuff. So here you have an aircraft carrier belching out smoke all around Europe. And let's say you want to blow that aircraft carrier up if it doesn't blow itself up in the process. Where are you going to attack it? Are you going to go search the northern sea for it, the Arctic Ocean? Are you going to search it like the middle of the Med? Or are you going to say, hey, that aircraft carrier is going to Syria? There's a nice little Strait of Gibraltar, which means that aircraft carrier has to pass through that one little spot. Wouldn't it be lovely to just wait in that one point in the kill chain to blow it up where it's the most convenient place to blow up a Russian aircraft carrier? I think I actually just got banned from Russia now. But anyway, so there you are, and that's the point of doing it. You want to attack something where it's the perfect place. And if they're going to attack you, that's the perfect place to stop it at a nice choke point. So understanding the kill chain methodology can help you understand where is the best place to stop an attacker. Because one of the biggest fallacies I see in the whole security, not just user awareness, is everybody says we have to stop the attackers. We got to prevent them from getting in. The reality is you got to prevent them from getting out. People are eventually going to get in, and you got to implement detection and reaction. So if you can look at a kill chain, yes, let the bad guys get to a certain place as long as we can stop them before they achieve their inevitable goal. That's a successful security program, and that's what a kill chain helps you to do. Where is it most cost effective? Now, we have this traditional kill chain that if you look at kill chain definitions, I'll talk you through it, but basically you find a potential target, you fix on your target, you track the target, then you start engaging, in other words, you try to blow it up, and then you assess whether you cause damage if you have to go back and blow it up again and stuff like that. So again, you might want to blow up that Russian aircraft carrier that's getting me banned from Russia now. You follow it around, you fix on it, you track it, and then you target it at the appropriate place. And then if you try to blow it up and you see if it's really damaged irreparably or whatever, then you go back and blow it up again if necessary. But the more important part for your concerns is, well, how is the adversary going to come after you? Because you have to understand how they're going to come after you so you can figure out where to target them best, where to prevent them best. So again, in target identification, and I'll talk about this later, they can identify you as a target anywhere in the world, and you're not going to stop them from targeting you. That's a given. If you have anything of value, somebody's eventually going to come after you or whatever the case is. So then the target does, they identify you, they send forces, and I'll step through this process in a second. But in the security world, the destruction of target, that, you know, again, I'm using military terminology, but destruction of target in our world could be the capture of data, or it could be the destruction and infiltration of systems. In other words, computer network attack or computer network exploitation. That's essentially what destruction of target means in the cybersecurity world. Now, as we mentioned before, the human has become the choice vector. Because what happens is technology, breaking into technology can be really hard. Bad guys, believe me, the first place bad guys do want to try to target you is they do want to try to bypass technology. That's what zero-day exploits are good for and so on. But the reality is that a lot of people have protection set up, and the easiest way to get into an organization is by targeting a human. And the reason that is not necessarily because humans are easier than technology, but because if a human already has inside access, that inside access gets them much more data a lot more quickly. So they will try to target a user, first off, because it's a soft target, but also because it's a more fruitful target as well, so you have to look at it. And generally, they know there's going to be poor security awareness. They know there's going to be poor controls, not on the human, but around the human. And we'll talk about, this is what this presentation is supposed to try to do, create an environment that makes the human a more hard target, essentially, both by securing the human better and by making the technology around the human more resistant to attack. So again, assume the human target, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, target identification. I got some really cool pictures. I got to admit, them making me get pictures, there were some really cool ones there. But anyway, target identification. You basically do reconnaissance. That's what it means. So if I'm targeting, I don't know, an organization, I'll stop picking on Russia. I'm not going to pick on any company. But if I want to target company.com, what do? I can go to public records on the internet. I could look if I want to physically enter a building. At most courthouses, they have building diagrams I can get. You want to go ahead and get people, you go on LinkedIn and all these other places so that you can figure out more about a company than the company knows about itself. By just Googling a company, you can find out their technology, you can find out who they use as vendors, you can find out who they have as contractors, and so on. You can find all their employees, all by doing open source recon, reconnaissance, and other sorts of stuff. Now, this is a really cool picture if it shows up well. But anyway, so, and then when we talk about forced dispatch. Forced dispatch in this case means how are they actually going to target you? How are they actually going to attack you? So in some cases, it might be USB drops. In other cases, it might be phishing attacks. In some cases, again, pretext phone calls, physical entry by tailgating people. It might be calling people up and all that sort of stuff. Vishing, I don't know how many people know. There's the proper term of vishing and then, you know, the improper term. Vishing basically means that somebody calls somebody up, like in accounts payable. This is a common scam we have to deal with. Somebody calls up accounts payable and says, you guys never paid my invoice. And it's like, what do you mean we never paid your invoice? It's like, oh, well, can I have your email address? I'll send you my invoice right now so you can open it up now. And the person's like, here's my email address. They send it to that person while they're on the phone and they say, can you see my invoice? And it'll be like a malicious, like Adobe PDF file or something like that. And that downloads malware on there. So it's a combination of voice pretext phone call, sending a phishing message almost immediately thereafter by priming the person to open up the message. That's what it means. But again, a whole bunch of different attacks, and I'm sure most of you are familiar with all of them. Then there's the actual destruction of target. After somebody has entered and they've gone ahead, they've done one of the attacks, then they try to execute the actions, whether it's the collection of data, whether it's destroying data. Ransomware is a major concern. I heard there was a ransomware summit yesterday for a lot of people. So again, ransomware is, again, they somehow get the user to install ransomware in one way or another. You can implant listening devices with physical entry and so on. Each attack, again, like I mentioned, has its own kill chain. For each attack, there's a different way, because I can tell you, here's step one, here's step two, here's step three. But for phishing attacks, that's one methodology of attacking. There's different points in a phishing attack where you can stop the attack. There's different points in a USB drop where you can stop the attack. And USB drop is where, like, you take a USB drive with malicious software on it and hope that some user plugs it in. And there's different ways of preventing it. There's different ways of them attacking you and so on. But you have to look at the potential ways of doing it. Now, with that, you have to consider, what is the governance? Because too many people in awareness programs ignore governance like it's just those annoying documents that you have to sit on a shelf and show the auditors once a year. Governance should be so much more than that. You got to start considering, are policies, procedures, and guidelines, in other words, telling people how to do things step by step, are they actually specific for what should be a good security program of protection, detection, and reaction? So for example, there should be some guidelines or procedures, whichever you want to call them, where if somebody's in accounts payable, that accounts payable person has to know, how do you deal with a person who is sending you information? If a person calls you up in the first place, well, you get the right person who should be properly trained to take calls from vendors. That person goes through a step of, you know, that person has a step review process for potential documents and review and so on. So as that person gets the call, they say, yes, okay, I see that, I don't know if you're in the system. If you send the invoice over, that's fine. However, don't send it up as a PDF. I need you to mail that PDF file into our accounts payable system, and then I will recover it out of the accounts payable system now as we're talking on the phone. And that's what the process should be. if companies have the process. And if it's not in the system, I'm sorry. Even if I look at it now, I can't do anything. You need to send it to the system first, and I will pull it up. And I've had invoices where I've had to do that, and that should be how it's done. But most people don't do that. But also, as appropriate, user problems should not be just solved by awareness. You have to figure out what are the technologies. So I'll talk about this a lot later, but multi-factor authentication, like, you know, the secure ID tokens and so on, like Google Authenticator for people who have Gmail and Google accounts, like, you know, Google for work accounts and stuff, those should be standard practice for people. So technology, even if somebody social engineers a password, that should stop the attack in progress. So anyway, I'm going to start talking about the phishing kill chain for a second, and I started mentioning this. There are 10 opportunities to stop a phishing attack. Only 7 of them are technological. Oh, so sorry, 9 are within your control, 7 are technology-based, 2 are user-based, and again, anywhere along the 10 phases you can stop the attack. This is actually kind of cool. I pulled this image off of somebody who stole my presentation before, so that was kind of funny. Anyway, later detection, and here's another concept that people need to be aware of regarding the kill chain process. If I see an attack in progress later in the exploitation chain, I can go back and potentially stop it. And let me give you a quick example. If I see a phishing message come in and a user tells me, here's a phishing message that I received, and I opened it up and it looks like a phishing message, they send it to the mail administrator. The mail administrator can then go in and delete all copies of that message off of the mail server, because potentially some people might have received that same phishing message and not opened it up yet. So if it hasn't been opened up yet and you could delete that out of people's inboxes, you will stop other cases of the attack, and I'll go through a case of how that works in the future. But again, future mitigation. So keep that in mind. Just because somebody attacks one user, they're probably going to attack a lot of users. So you want to go back and prevent that same other users from being attacked in the same way if you can. This picture has nothing to do with my slides, but they want a picture, so there's a picture. So one of the key things for the mail server is, like, for a phishing message to get to a user, what's the first thing that has to happen? People ignore this concept. Somewhere on the internet, millions of systems are compromised in parts of botnets. And as being part of these botnets, what happens? Somebody's compromised all these systems, and these systems are sending millions of messages to you. Now, in theory, you could blacklist these messages. I think, what is it, the anti-phishing working group has some, like, malware. Oh, sorry, they have a list of systems that should be blacklisted and stuff. But again, those are systems on the internet that, unless you blacklist them, most companies have no way of preventing them. But be aware that the first part of the attack is knowing this is a vulnerability, poorly secured systems on the internet. The second point of a phishing kill on the phishing kill chain are your mail servers. Somehow the message has got into your mail server and it's sitting there. Now, theoretically, what could your mail server do? You could say, this message is a phishing message. This message has an .exe file that looks like a ransomware attack. I'm going to kill this file right now. I'm going to delete the message or whatever the case is. I'm going to inform them that the user, maybe there's a message, but it needs to be reviewed by somebody. So the second phase is, and again, purely technological, the second phase are the mail servers that should filter out a potential phishing email message. Third phase is the email finally gets to the user. The email gets to the email client of the user, and it sits in the box. And now the client software, purely technological, can go ahead and say, this is a valid message, or this is a spam message, or a phishing message. And not only that, is it like in the application, like Microsoft Outlook and other email browsers have this capability to filter out potential spam messages. You can even load anti-malware software on the system and attach it as a plugin to your your mail client, and that even has a separate potential filter as well. So that should, even before the user looks at their email client, it should be filtered out as spam or something else. Again, pure technology. Now we get to where the user can start being stupid. Now you get to the user, what's the first thing that happens? The user looks in their inbox and says, okay, I need to know if this message is a phishing message or not a message, or whatever it happens to be. Sometimes the message is obvious, sometimes it's not obvious. Don't worry about what's in that little window. Again, it's only a picture that they like pictures. So anyway, that's a picture of an email client. So what happens is, user can leave it there and look at it, or if it's in the spam filter, the user can say, do I want to open up this message that's in the spam filter? And then the user, you never know. I mean, sorry, we're here at RSA's conference. You know, how many people remember the incident where the secure ID software was stolen from RSA? Okay, a few people do. That happened because a bad person, likely from China, went ahead and sent a spreadsheet onto an outdated email client. It was like the spreadsheet supposedly came from Munster.com or some other recruiting website, went to somebody in HR. The person in HR, the file was actually in the spam filter itself. The user went into the spam filter, said, oh, well, maybe this message shouldn't be spam, and they opened up a file with a zero-day attack in it. That was a bad thing to do. And then China was sitting there waiting for them, and like all of a sudden the software installed, China got detected the software installed, they got on the system, and then once they were on the system, they tunneled throughout RSA really quickly and found the secure ID software and downloaded it, and then they used it to attack Lockheed Martin later. So that happened a few months later where they did a brute force attack against secure ID token logons at Lockheed Martin to try to steal like military stuff. But again, that happened because some user opened up something in their spam file. But before the user should be allowed to open up something stupid in their spam file, the system should say, hey, this is kind of stupid. Do you really want to do that? And the user then has to go ahead and say, hey, wait a second. Do I want to do this? And the user can say, yeah, I really want to be stupid. I want to click on that email message. Or the user can be really smart and say, you know what? The message was in the spam filter in the first place. The system came up and warned me. I think I'm going to leave it in the spam filter. Or if the user wants to be stupid, the user does go ahead and click on it, and then the user clicks on it, and what's the next thing that should happen? Now the software kicks back in. So for example, on every system, and I don't know about your organizations, but the average user should not have the ability to install software on their systems. That's how malware gets on the system, where somebody goes ahead and says, we're sending you a file. The person says, well, maybe I'll open up the file. The system says, it's really stupid. Do you really want to open up the file? And the person says, yeah, I really want to open up the file. The system should say, okay, you clicked on it, you wanted to, but no, you don't have permission to do it, and it should stop it there. And if companies would implement this practice, ransomware would go away in almost 100% of the cases. Okay, thank you. So anyway, then the next thing is, so even if you install ransomware or malware or the user clicks on a link and gives up their user ID and password, the next thing that needs to happen is the network should stop it. So the network should say, hey, why are you tunneling out of my PC out to this malicious network, onto the dark web through a Tor link or something? Or why is this software on the PC attempting to contact a command and control server that's working as a Chinese botnet or something like that? So the network should detect the attack and prevent the action. Web content filters should stop the acts as well, and so on. Then the network should also detect successful attacks. The network kicks back in and says, we need to isolate the system. Not only prevent the actions, but start detecting it and start cleaning it up, or at least isolating the system from causing more harm. Detected compromises should then be mitigated. Again, the system should figure it out. They isolate the system in question. Then they go ahead and say, we're locking it up. We're going to deinstall it. We're then going to fix it and put it back on the network and so on. So pretty much I just went through everything that's on the kill chain summary. You're going to get the slides. If you're not going to get the slides, somebody's taking pictures of it. Make friends with him or something like that. I have to move on quickly, but I'll give you the slides if you want them. Anyway, this is a slide that for some reason they put in there that I don't know why. Maybe they wanted more pictures. Anyway, but then now here's the other concept, backward mitigation, like I mentioned. If anywhere in the kill chain you detect you're under attack that was not detected previously, you can go back in and wipe out the attacks in progress. So for example, if somebody gets a social engineering call and somebody gets on the phone and says, hey, I have a call and somebody called me up and wants my user ID and password. They contact the security team. The security team then goes out and say, okay, we're broadcasting a message that says somebody is attempting to social engineer everybody. So they implement an emergency awareness message that says, we're under attack. Please do not give out your password to anybody. And I'll show you how that occurred in a second. But anyway, so domains can be blocked. So if a phishing message comes in and the phishing message tries to send you to a phishing site that tries to get user IDs and passwords, you can block the site at the firewall to make sure it doesn't go out, users can't go out and enter, even if they click on it. So you can stop the attacks in progress if you somehow find the attacks that even if they've gone too far already, you can stop future attacks and stuff. Now, here's a case study that came out of this. And so I gave a presentation 3 years ago or so on the Syrian Electronic Army. I call the Syrian Electronic Army the cockroaches that they are. Hopefully that's being recorded so they could see this again. But I call the Syrian Electronic Army cockroaches, and I was informed that in the Muslim world, that is a grave offense to call somebody a cockroach. I'm like, well, they are. I'll get over it. They should too. So anyway, what happened was when the RSA put up my video of the session, like late 4 hours later, a message, like somebody, like I got a tweet to Ira Winkler, my Twitter account, that said, who's the, you know, Ira Winkler, go to this site. And I'm like, I'm not going to this site, you know? So anyway, then somebody contacted me, and they're like, Ira, did you go to the RSA page? I'm like, no. So somebody, what happened was the Syrian Electronic Army found a vulnerability in the RSA conference webpage that linked back to a graphic image that called, who's the cockroach now, Ira Winkler? And I'm like sitting there like, what do I care? You hack RSA conference site, no offense, guys. But anyway, so it's like, so literally what they did was, and you have to give them these imbeciles a little bit of credit, because what these imbeciles did was they found out that there was a, how do you phrase it? That when you go to the RSA conference site, the RSA conference uses Lucky Orange, which tracks your cursor movements around the website, just FYI, guys. So anyway, it tracks your cursor movements. And then they found out that when you go there, it kicks off a JavaScript program. And then when it kicks off, what they did was, they found out who the domain controller was for the JavaScript program destination. And they basically sent spear phishing messages to the company that hosted the domain. And the domain itself was locked, but the subdomain was not locked. So it's w1.livestatserver.com, not, you know. So what they did was they changed the pointer to w1, subdomain of livestatserver.com, to point to an image file on the internet. So anyway, that's how it hacked the RSA conference site. So then what happened was I'm like, well, I better get in front of this story. So I wrote an article how stupid these people were to have attacked the, I mean, frankly, if you're going to attack the RSA conference site, I would attack it just before like the call for papers goes in or something. They wasted one of the best attacks against the security community to call me a name. So anyway, they went ahead, took down the RSA conference site. I put this up, and then they were offended that I called them idiots again. So then they went ahead and hacked the Wall Street Journal Twitter feeds. So they went ahead, sent spear phishing messages to whoever controls the Wall Street Journal TweetDeck accounts. And they went ahead and then sent out a message like, breaking news, Ira Winkler is the cockroach of the internet. So anyway, they did that. And so then, this is a BuzzFeed message. I'll come back to BuzzFeed in a second. So then what happened was they hacked four accounts of the Wall Street Journal. Some idiot reporter of the Wall Street Journal retweeted that. I want to hack his account for the point of it. But anyway, the guy didn't even read what he was retweeting. So then after they did this, CNN calls me up because when CNN was hacked, the Wall Street Journal made a big story about it. So now the Wall Street Journal was hacked, so CNN wanted to make a big story about this. So then CNN interviewed me, and when CNN interviewed me, I gave them like this nice big, you know, again, calling them cockroaches and what idiots they were. So then the next day, they hacked the BuzzFeed Twitter accounts to call me a cockroach again. And then, you know, the editor from BuzzFeed was, he's like, you know, he's talking, I was finding out step by step how they did it against spear phishing message. So the guy comes to me and he says, no offense, but who the F are you that these people are taking down my, targeting me because of you? I go, I don't know, these people are just imbeciles. The FBI told me they hate me more than they hated Obama. And like, even the Syrians were like, you know, even Syrian intelligence were like, why are you idiots targeting him when you could have done so much better? So then later that day, they sent out on the compromised account, they sent out another message saying, BuzzFeed, don't report on Syria anymore. I couldn't make that up. I was more of a target than them worrying about what's going on in Syria. So then I decided to write an article on how the Syrian Electronic Army essentially jumped the shark, if you know the reference. So I wrote an article because they're like, these people are just calling you names. That's not even newsworthy anymore. Plenty of people call me names. This is just a new group of people. So what happened was we went ahead and we knew the Syrian Electronic Army, based upon threat intelligence, would target Computer World and the IDG media network that owns Computer World. So what we did was we put an awareness program together saying to everybody in IDG saying, you're likely going to be attacked. Spear phishing messages will look like they come from an executive and will look like this, this, and this, because we knew the methodology they would use. And they'll say, please go to this link with the spear phish, you know, and it'll say it'll be from an executive. So anyway, they posted the article. Within 4 hours, a whole bunch of phishing messages came in, and these people were so stupid. The phishing message was from an executive that left the company 2 months before. And then what happened was everybody was already on the lookout for these messages. The people knew. When people received the messages, they contacted the security team. The security team blocked the domain, so even if people weren't aware it was a phishing message, they couldn't get out to the site where it went to. And they also went ahead and deleted all the messages off. The Syrian Electronic Army claimed they got a password, but the passwords were like, you know, like user ID Assad@despot.com, and you know, password was like bite me or something like that. And they claimed that was a win. So anyway, the users were warned, and they were able to go back and mitigate the whole attack proactively because they detected the message in process. So now here's the thing. With awareness, there's no common sense without common knowledge. I try to repeat this as much as possible. Clicking on a phishing message, not putting a USB drive in a system, you know, not opening a door for a stranger, everybody says that's common sense. It's not common sense. Security professionals are so stupid because they think all these people have common sense when they're not giving people common knowledge. In the security profession, we have common knowledge by observing these attacks and reporting on these attacks day after day after day. The average person doesn't know that. So you have to work to give people common knowledge so they can exercise common sense. And again, like I mentioned before, technology failures are prominent. Like I mentioned at the beginning, 90% of all user-caused damage is a result of a bad environment. It's not a result of user stupidity. But let's face it, users can be stupid too. So again, only when technology fails, even if there's a really stupid user, only when technology fails can the user cause damage to the network. Anyway, yeah, I do have my user not off the hook type of thing. But anyway, users still have to take responsibility. It's just like if there's a bad encryption program out there, if there's bad encryption, if there's bad, you know, like, file server security, bad anti-malware and stuff, that has to be prevented too. But users have to get better as well. In summary, you got to acknowledge that user failure anywhere in the kill chain is not just a result of a stupid user. When users fail, it's a sign of your network, and because I'm out of time theoretically, I'll just say again, if a user click can take down your network sucks. If a user putting a USB drive inside a PC on a nuclear facility can destroy your whole nuclear facility, your nuclear facility security sucks. So you gotta stop blaming the user. You gotta start looking, even if a user does something really stupid, why was the user allowed to do it? You created an environment for them, and if you can stop them, you can, you know, that's what you gotta look for, creating a comprehensive, holistic program, whether it's a user error or not. Apply slide, you know, they just make me put in an apply slide. But basically, go ahead, you can read that later. Have a new book that covers most of this, Advanced Persistent Security. It's the only sales pitch you'll get. Buy my book. I'm doing a book sign on Thursday. Awesome book, by the way. 5 stars, Amazon.com, yada, yada, yada. And then I'm done. Any questions? Nobody has questions. Well, have a lovely day then. And if you love this, I'm giving it tomorrow at 2:45 again. And it'll probably be a completely different presentation because I never remember what I said. Anyway, see you all later. Thanks, guys.